Have you snagged yourself an ultimate starter box for Age of Sigmar? And all you can think about is playing your first game of 4th edition Warhammer Age of Sigmar?
Well, we're here to help you painting this epic box set as quickly as possible so you can deploy it onto the gaming table and face down your opponents with an awesomely painted army.
This video will be a whistle-stop tour through painting this box set, focusing on the strategy behind tackling such a hefty project. Whether you're painting the mighty Stormcast Eternals or the villainous Skaven, or even both, we've got you covered.
You can use this guide for painting the standard starter set as well. So if you picked up one of those boxes, this video is perfect for you too. Adam is now going to talk to you about the fundamentals of painting, and then start to crack on with some Stormcast Eternals painted ready for battle.
Thanks a lot, Emma. In this video, we'll be taking you through how to paint this set using the Warhammer Age of Sigmar paints and tool set. These paints are on the screen right now. Remember that these are your miniatures, and it's up to you how you paint them. Feel free to add in or change paints. Don't worry if you're brand new to painting. We'll walk you through everything you need to know to paint every miniature in the box. In our Warhammer Age of Sigmar paints and tool set, we can find a pair of clippers, a little metal tool called a mold line remover, and all the paints that we'll need to get our miniatures from the Ultimate Starter set finished and ready for battle. So, let's get started on the process. Before painting, you'll need to build your miniatures. However, before building, it's always best to read the construction booklet first. This is super important, as getting the miniatures parts in the right order makes assembly easier. You may also notice in some model kits that there are options for different variants of the same models, as we can see with our Stormcast Eternal Liberators. These could be different weapons or a different helmet. So make sure you read the instructions well before assembly so you know what miniature you want to build. Now, let's build our first Stormcast Eternal Liberator. To build our miniatures, we need a few tools. First, we need to take our clippers and our sprue in hand. Next, we're going to put the flat side of the clipper to the model side. This avoids damaging any components we need and gives us a clearer cut too. Gently squeeze the clippers and the component will come away from the sprue. Once we have the pieces clipped out, we'll use the mold line remover to clean up any mold lines left from the sprue. The thinner nose gives greater precision to get into harder to reach mold lines. This helps the model look tidy and makes it easier to paint. Now, we know how to clip and clean our models. We can put them together. You would have noticed that in your paint and tool set that you don't have any plastic glue. Disaster! But wait. If we look closely at our model and the instructions, we can see that we don't need glue. All of the miniatures in the Ultimate Starter Set and the Starter Set are easy to build miniatures, also known as push fit. These are monopose models that don't need gluing together and come in less pieces. So, let's start with our easy to build model. When clipping out the bits for your push fit models, just be careful not to clip off the pegs on the parts. These are what will hold our model together instead of glue, so take your time so you don't clip those off by accident. Now, we have our first parts, we can start pushing them together. Push firmly, but not too hard, as we want these pieces to fit together, but not snap or break. Then, after your last piece is pushed in place, we can push our model onto its base. These models have pegs on the bottom of the feet and a hole in the base, so you don't have to glue it down either. Now you know how to build your push fit models. Once you've done this, it's time to set up a painting area. Make sure you've got a hard surface to paint on and a covering for it to prevent any damage in the event of paint spillage. Don't worry, we've all done it. You'll need a water pot and something to use as a palette. An old plate or a piece of cardboard will work just fine. Okay, so the first model we're going to paint is the Lord Vigilant on Griff Charger. The Lord Vigilants are steadfast commanders of the Ruination Chambers. They wield not only hallowed great axes, but also centuries of experience leading the charge in the God King's name, and thus make excellent examples for how to go about painting the Hammers of Sigmar Chamber of Stormcast Eternals. Every step that we'll do here can be done on the rest of the Stormcast Eternals in the Ultimate Starter Set and Starter Set. When there are a few different things to do on other models, we'll show you how to do those as well. The first thing that we need to do is undercoat our model. Because there is a lot of gold on our Stormcast Eternals, using Retributor Armour as our undercoat will be perfect. The undercoat is an important part of the painting process. It will give a layer of paint on the model for all future layers to sit on nicely. If you don't do an undercoat, you could potentially start to see areas on your models where your paint easily rubs off the plastic. With that being said, we need to make sure that our undercoat is nice and thin because we don't want to clog up any details with too thick paint. So we'll thin out our Retributor Armour with some water so it's not too thick and goopy, and then start completely covering the entire model. You'll notice that the paint doesn't cover completely in the first pass. Don't worry. Let the layer dry and then come back to do another layer. This way you build up to good coverage with multiple thin layers of paint so you don't obscure any details. Take your time with this. The end result is worth the process. Okay, with our model now fully undercoated and looking nice and shiny, we need to start to block in our base coats. Base coating is when we paint, normally with base paints, the main colors that make up the model. For our first base coat, we'll be using Abaddon Black to paint the Griff Charger, any leather details that we can see, and the small cloak. Again, remember to thin out your paint with a little water before applying it so it's not too thick and obscures details. Right, we now need to carefully pick out the inner cloak with Corax White. Don't be afraid to turn the model upside down to make access easier when painting this area. Once the inner cloak is painted, we need to look for other white details such as the shield motif and various trinkets on the model. Be careful when going near any previously painted areas. If you do make a mistake, just tidy back up with the right colors. Our model is starting to come together nicely now. So it's now time to pick out all of the silver details, and for this, we'll be using Leadbelcher. These details will be the chainmail, buckles, nails, and various bits of armor. If you get lost as to where these are, a good trick is to check the box art as a guide to where to apply the paint. Once you finish blocking in all of the silver details, remember to refresh the water in your water pot, as we don't want any metallic flakes getting mixed in with the rest of our paints. All right, we'll now pick out the outer cloak, ribbons, shield, and shoulder pads with Kantor Blue. You'll find that Kantor Blue covers really nicely and gives a wonderfully deep and rich shade of blue. As always, completely cover the areas that you want to be blue with your first layer. Don't worry if it hasn't covered perfectly. Wait for your layer to dry completely and then come back to do another. After 2 to 3 layers, your blue areas will be completely covered and look awesome. Okay, we're now going to use Kantor Blue again, but in a completely different way. We want to create the blue flames that we can see on the box art. We'll need to thin down the paint with loads of water. This helps to dilute the pigment and thus make the coverage really transparent. It's almost like making your own shade paint. We're then going to cover all the flame details with our wash. A neat little trick that you can do with your paints. We're looking to pick out the weapon handle, gemstones, and Griff Charger's eyes next, and for this we'll be using Khorne Red. We'll need to be careful going around our previously painted details. Take a bit more time when painting the little gems and the Griff Charger's eyes as well. A good tip when painting eyes is to try and use just the tip of your brush for more control. And if you can, hold your breath, because this will help to steady your paintbrush. If you do make a mistake here, tidy back up with the previous colors. Next, we'll be using Rakarth Flesh to pick out any parchment that we can find. We'll also pick out the scenery that the Griff Charger is on, and then move on to painting its beak. Rakarth Flesh is a great utility paint that can be used for various different elements when you're painting your models. Remember to give it a really good shake before opening it up as well. This will help to mix the color nicely. You should also add a bit of water to your paint once you've got it on the palette to help the paint flow off your brush with greater control. Okay, time to block in our last section. This will be the Griffstalker's horns and leather straps that we can find on the model. We'll be using Steel Legion Drab for this. Just make sure to be careful painting around the previously painted details. We're almost done with our Lord Vigilant. Just a couple more steps to go. Alright, with all of our base coats picked out, we now need to add some depth to a few of our colors. For this, we'll be using a shade paint called Agrax Earthshade. We're going to apply this paint all over the metallics, Rakarth Flesh details, the scenery, beak and parchment, the Griff Charger's horns, as well as any areas where we have used Khorne Red. When applying shade paint, we don't want the shade pooling, so if you see that happening, dry off your brush and soak up the excess paint. We're purposely not applying it over the white and blue details, as we want them to look a bit more bold and stand out. However, if you want to apply the Agrax Earthshade over them, feel free to do so. Okay, with our model completed, we now need to focus on the base. For this, we'll be using a technical paint called Astrogranite that is perfect for simulating rocky terrain. In order to use this, we'll be using our trusty Citadel texture tool. If you don't have a texture tool, you can easily use your mold line remover, or you could cut some handy strips from your plastic packaging. If you are under 18, please ask a responsible adult to help you with cutting the plastic. As you can see here, the mold line remover works well to add texture to your bases. Just remember to clean it up straight after use so you don't have any dry texture on it when you want to try to clean your models. If you'd rather not use your mold line remover, the strips of plastic packaging is also a handy alternative that works just as well. However, please do not use your starter brush, as the texture paint will destroy your brush. It has lots of bits of sand in the paint that helps to make the base texture that will damage your brush. If you're using the Citadel texture tool, you'll notice on the tool that it has two scoops on it, a larger one and a smaller one. Use the larger scoop to get the paint out of the pot and apply it to the base. Once it is on the base, you can then push it around so it starts to cover the area. When you get near any details, you can switch to the smaller scoop so you can be more accurate with your application. When the entire base is covered, let it stand and dry for around an hour before doing anything else. Now that the Astrogranite is completely dry, we need to shade it as well. For this, we'll use Agrax Earthshade again and apply it all over the base. Remember to give the pot a really good shake before applying, as this will mix the shade nicely. Again, just be mindful of any excess pooling anywhere, and if there is, dry off your brush and soak it up with the dry bristles. And there we go, our Lord Vigilant on Griff Charger is completed and looks awesome. You should be really happy with what you've done, as you've tackled a big model and got him completed and ready to take on the enemies of Sigmar. All of the paints and steps we've done on him are repeated throughout the rest of the Stormcast models in this box set, so you can always use this section of the video as a good reference point for where you need to apply your colors. However, we're going to show you how to do a few more tips and tricks that will make your painting process easier for your Stormcast Eternals. Right. When you're tackling a large box like this, it's often best to do something called batch painting. This is painting a group of the same miniatures at once, stage by stage, completing the stage on one miniature and then moving to the next miniature to repeat the process. Doing this means we're never sitting around waiting for paint to dry, and instead we're using all our time efficiently. So let's start with three of the awesome Liberator models that we have made. As you can see, we've already undercoated them, just like what we did with the Lord Vigilant, with Retributor Armour. We're now going to start with our first paint, Leadbelcher, and pick out some of the details with it. Once we've done all of the details on our first Liberator, we'll move on to the next one to repeat the process, and so on and so forth. We've got three Liberators in our batch, but you can do all five at once if you want to. Okay, we're picking out the scale mail, hammerheads, and working metals with Leadbelcher. Try to be as neat as you can around any areas that you know you want to be gold, because you'll need to tidy those back up. Just keep your pot of Retributor Armour to hand during the process. Next, we're painting the undertunic with Abaddon Black, making our way around the models, carefully picking out these details. When that is done, we'll move on to using Kantor Blue to pick out the shoulder pads and inner shield detail. You'll notice that once this is done, your Liberators pop to life really nicely. Okay, time to start to use Steel Legion Drab to pick out all of the leather details. These will be on the belt, scabbard, and straps that we can find on our Liberators. With that completed, we're using Khorne Red to paint the weapon handles, gemstones, and the plume of hair that we can find on our leader. Right, it's time to use Rakarth Flesh to paint any ribbons on the Liberators and stones that we can find on the base. We'll now use Corax White to carefully paint the shield motif, trims, and any scales that we can find on the base. When doing the shield motif and trim, just take a bit more time to be as careful as you can. However, if you do make a mistake, you can always tidy back up with the previous colors. Okay, that's all our base coats done. We're now going to shade the metallics, red, leather, parchment, stone, and skull details that we can find, leaving the white and blue details unshaded. However, if you do want to shade those details, feel free to do so. While our shade is drying, we're going to move on to getting our base done, and we'll be using Astrogranite to do this. Just like how we did the Lord Vigilant, we'll use the large flat end of our texture tool to scoop out the paint and plonk it on the base, and then the smaller end to carefully maneuver it around our models. Once we've got all of the bases done, go make yourself a nice hot or cold drink and leave your models to dry for around an hour. Perfect. Now that our texture paint is dry, our last step is to shade all of the Astrogranite with Agrax Earthshade. When all of the bases are covered, you'll need to let them stand and dry for around 20 minutes. Give yourself a big pat on the back as you've just completed your first ever batch painted miniatures. Okay, we've got our Lord Vigilant painted, and now we've shown you how to batch paint some Stormcast Eternal Liberators. Remember that you don't just have to batch paint a particular type of unit, as long as most of the colors are the same, you can batch paint various different types of units to help speed up the process. As it happens, Stormcast Eternals are really well suited for this. The next thing we're going to show you is how to paint the wings of the Prosecutors. Now, from looking at the box art, they do look really intimidating to paint, but we're going to show you how to get these done really quickly and easily. You'll notice that we've painted all of the rest of the details of our Prosecutors following the steps that we did earlier in the video, so it's just the wings left to paint. The first thing that we need to do is completely cover the inner wings with Corax White. We'll need a couple of layers for good coverage. Leave the outer armor looking areas gold, like how I have done. Thin out your Corax White with a little bit of water to ensure that your paint isn't too thick and goopy when applying it. Remember to let your first layer dry completely before coming back to do another layer. You'll most likely need 2 to 3 coats of this to get a nice even coverage across the wings. And then the last step of this process is to repeat how we did the blue flame effect on our Lord Vigilant. Once we've thinned out our Kantor Blue with a load of water, roughly a 1:5 ratio, we'll then apply our mix over the flame looking details of the wings, leaving the more rigid inner details Corax White. If you overspill at any point, just tidy back up with Corax White as well. And there we go, our Prosecutor wings are finished. All that's left to do is base our unit like how we based our Lord Vigilant and Liberators. Next, we'll be moving on to showing you how to quickly paint the Griffcrow. We'll need to undercoat our Griffcrow, and for this we'll be using Abaddon Black. Luckily enough for us, Abaddon Black serves as the main color for most of the other details as well, so it works out really nicely as it'll be our base coat for all of the feather details. As always, thin out your paint and build up a good solid coverage with multiple layers. Once you've finished undercoating, the next areas we'll be picking out are the beak and the stone details we can find on the base. For this, we'll be using Rakarth Flesh. With that completed, we'll move on to picking out the leather and talons with Steel Legion Drab. Try to be as neat as you can going around your previously painted details. Okay, we'll now pick out the armor and any trinkets that we can see with Retributor Armour for that classic gold look and to make our Griffcrow fit in with the rest of our Stormcast Eternals. With all the gold picked out, we're now moving on to the silver details, and for this we'll be using Leadbelcher. Just look for any working metals and pick these out. If you need a guide, always remember that you can check out the box art as reference. Now that the metallics are based, we're going to paint the red details with Khorne Red. We'll pick out the eyes and gems that we can find on the model. Remember, when painting eyes, to try and use the point of your brush for better control. Alright, all of our base coats are done, so we're now going to shade our Griffcrow with Agrax Earthshade. Remember, when applying shade, to just keep an eye out for any pooling. If you see some, dry off your brush and then soak up the excess paint with dry bristles. Time to apply the Astrogranite texture paint. We're experts at this now, so just remember that once you've completely covered the base, let it stand and dry for around an hour before doing anything else. If you need a reminder on how to apply Astrogranite, just refer to earlier in the video when we did the same step on our Lord Vigilant. With the Astrogranite done, we'll now shade it with Agrax Earthshade. And there we go, our Griffcrow is complete. Okay, with our Griffcrow done, all that's left to paint is our Lord Veritant. You can paint this model in its entirety by following the steps of the Lord Vigilant. It uses all the same colours for all the same types of detail. When you've completed him, your Stormcast Eternals are finished and ready to take to the battlefield. Emma will now run you through how to paint your Skaven and the bits of scenery that come with the Ultimate Starter set. I can't wait to see how awesome they'll look.
Thanks, Adam. Now it's time for the Skaven. These vicious vermin are found underground in the mortal realms. But now the hordes are breaching the cities of the God King Sigmar. These models are really fun to build and paint. So we'll be using the same techniques as we used on the Stormcast Eternals Adam painted, but with just a few different colours on some really unique details. Now let's get started with the Claw Lord and Gnaw Beast. This may be a big model, but don't be intimidated. We'll break it down into nice bite-sized chunks for you to paint in. Painting this model first will help see where these colours will go on for the rest of our army. Then any details that are new or unique, we'll tackle along as we go. Just like with the Stormcast Eternals, we'll be starting by undercoating our model. We'll use Abaddon Black in several coats to build up that smoother layer for the rest of our paints to adhere to, one coat at a time. This will also give our Skaven a dark shadow in all those recesses and gaps, adding to their underground, sinister feel, especially when it comes to the darker base coats we'll be applying next. Great work! We've got our nasty looking beast and its master ready for painting. And now we can start base coating. And first off, we'll paint the skin and fur on both the Claw Lord and Gnaw Beast with Rakarth Flesh. The same base coating rules apply here with our Skaven. One thin, smooth coat at a time, working around all those details, making sure that we get into those nooks and gaps, then leaving it to dry, ready for the second coat. Just make sure the Gnaw Beast's skin is coated evenly, seeing there is so much skin and fur visible on it. Don't worry if you get any of this colour on the other details, but let's try to be neat if we can. It will make our final result even neater and more even. As we are applying a lighter colour over a dark undercoat, you may need a third coat in some places, but hopefully you will have a smooth and even colour on the skin. With the Rakarth Flesh dried, we are ready to move on to our Khorne Red stage. We'll be using this colour for the Claw Lord's armour, a majority of the cloth it wears, the inside of the mouths and tongues, and the beady eyes. Remember to take your time, keep your paint on the palette wet, and make sure you have a good amount of paint on your brush. Not too much and not too little. For those smaller details, you might find it helps to keep the brush pointed. You can do this by rolling and twisting the brush on the palette after getting more paint. This brings all those hairs together and gives you a much better result when painting. After a couple of coats of that red, it looks like our Skaven duo is slowly coming to life. Let's keep going and add even more base coats. Now we have quite a few smaller details to focus on with Steel Legion Drab. We need to paint any wood, ropes, and leather details. Then we can cover any of those smaller bits of cloth that we left. And we can even paint those claws and teeth last as the smallest of the details. We can even use the black undercoat to our advantage here too. If we're neat with our application, the undercoat between details will not show through, but it will add a shadow to our details, making them stand out from each other even more. If you're a little messy with your application, don't worry, we all make mistakes. Just wait for this colour to dry and then tidy it up with the right colour afterwards. We are doing so well with this model, getting all those details done and in great time too. We're almost done with our base coats, just a few more to go. Next we'll paint the tails and the odd mutated patchy skin with Bugman's Glow. You'll see these patches all over the Gnaw Beast, as this large warpstone mutated creature has ripped through its own fur and skin. So just be careful of avoiding the outer layer of skin and fur that we've already painted. Right, with those tails done and the horrific flesh now painted, we can make those warpstones stand out. And now we want to paint the Claw Lord's halberd and the stone chunks embedded in the Gnaw Beast's skin. For this, we'll be using Waaagh flesh, giving it a dark green colour. Don't worry if you get any on the halberd's trim, as we'll be painting that next in a different colour. Just try and avoid the rest of the colours we've already painted. Our Clawlord and Norbeast are looking amazing so far, but we have one more base paint to apply. And now we can paint the metal details. And for this we'll use Leadbelcher. We can use this for the halberd trim, Norbeast's collar, any buckles, spikes, armour trim, the gun and any chainmail. We could also paint the spiky trophy rack on the Clawlord's back. Then once you've applied those couple of coats and let it dry, we can paint those skulls with Rakarth Flesh. Sometimes it's easier to paint one or two details after painting another in a different colour. It avoids tidying up and making more mistakes than normal. And with that last base paint applied, our Clawlord and Norbeast has so many colours and it's looking amazing. But we have the base they stand on still to paint. But don't worry, we'll use a lot of the same paints we've already used, so we can quickly add those on in no time. Now we are more confident with our painting skills, we can do this part nice and quick, but making sure that we're as neat as possible. For the Warpstone Miasma, we'll use Waaagh Flesh, getting it into all the nooks and gaps in the earth. Then we'll paint Steel Legion Drab onto the wooden struts and earth, and Leadbelcher on the metal details on afterwards. And to finish off, we'll paint the stones and rocks in Rakarth Flesh. With those details now painted, we are ready for our shading stage. Now we are ready for the shade stage of the Clawlord. Just like with the Stormcast side of this box, we'll use the same techniques when it comes to shading the Skaven. We want to make sure that we cover all the details of this model and its base with a light and even coat of Agrax Earthshade, making sure we avoid pooling and dark spots once it's dried. Some areas we want lighter than others, but we want to make sure we still apply enough shade so it doesn't make any streaks into the paint or dry too quickly, giving us a slight shiny or uneven finish. If you think you've applied too much in some areas, like the Rakarth Flesh or Steel Legion Drab details, you can remove some shade with your brush once you have cleaned and dried it off. But don't leave it too late, or you can't remove any shade once it's started drying. Our Clawlord, Norbeast and base are really looking amazing, so great work on painting it. So let's add our texture paint to really make it come to life. And we can finish off the base with our technical paint Astrogranite. We'll be using the texture tool here, but you can use the mold line remover or the plastic piece that Adam showed us earlier on. It's really up to you what you prefer to use. We'll use all three in the same way, to get the texture paint around the already painted details and get a nice coverage on the black base top. We just want to apply this around the already painted stones and earth, but we want to make sure that we get it into all the gaps and keep the rim of the base clean of this paint. Then once you've left that to dry for around an hour, we can paint the rim of the base with Abaddon Black. Well done! You just painted the Clawlord on Norbeast, the biggest and most detailed Skaven model in the box, so you should be super proud about what you've accomplished. But now we have the colours and steps in our memory, we can look at painting the rest of the models much easier now. We can just repeat the same steps for the same details. So let's look at the rest of the Skaven army and any extra unique details they may have. For the Greyseer, we have used the same steps so far for the majority of the details, but now we have some new details that we need to paint. Greyseers have these massive horns on their head, and for this detail, we'll use Steel Legion Drab. You can paint this detail at the same time as the rest of the other details in this colour. Just be careful of any skin or other details that are nearby. There is also a wooden beam attached to the bell, so don't forget to paint that too. Now we'll paint the fur in Corax White, as these ratmen have a shockingly bright or light grey fur compared to their verminous kin. Just a couple of thin coats on any tufts and on the jaw, and this will be plenty for this Skaven. Nice and quick, but do take your time with such a small detail. Then we can paint the cracked bell and the staff head with Retributor Armour, giving a couple of coats of a shiny gold to this model. You can do this at any stage, anytime, but it helps to do it around the same time as the Leadbelcher stages. Then you can clean your paint water afterwards. And now we have all our Greyseer base coated and we can keep on going. We don't need to add any Astrogranite here for our texture, as the base is a fully sculpted detailed base. Just make sure you follow the same steps as we did for our Clawlord's base and you'll all be done. So all there is left to do is to shade the details carefully and paint the rim of the base. Great work! Now let's keep going. When it comes to painting the Warplock Engineer, we just need to follow the same steps as our last two Skaven heroes. Just take your time, and if you aren't sure what to paint, you can always take a look at the box art to help you out. And it should look something like this. Nice and quick. Next up are the Clan Rats, and you'll get quite a lot of these small but feisty Skaven, so that's why we'll be batch painting these models. This time, I'll be batch painting three of them, but you can do as many as you like in one sitting. Just like with the Liberators, we'll undercoat our models first. One coat at a time for each Clan Rat. Then once the first coat is dry, we can apply the second and then the third. This is why batch painting is really helpful. It just doesn't get all your models painted, but it gives you enough time to paint another model at the same time as the last one is drying. This is really time economical and keeps you painting rather than waiting. Now we can apply Rakarth Flesh to the skin and fur one coat at a time. Seeing these Clan Rats have lots of different details, you may find some of them have skulls or some smaller rats on their bases. So you can use this colour for these as well. Right, moving on to the Khorne Red for the bigger cloth pieces and the banner flag. Don't worry about painting the eyes, as these are so small and you risk making a mess on the skin. With the cloth, you can paint whatever pieces you want. Making them more random will make each Clan Rat more unique. Then we can use our next colour for the other pieces. And that next colour is Steel Legion Drab for those other cloth pieces, any leather, ropes and wood. You can even add some to the banner flag if you wish. If you feel more comfortable with the smaller details, you can also paint the teeth and claws with this colour too. Just make sure that your brush has all its bristles together so it can be as neat as possible. Then for the tails and any tongues poking out, we'll just add a few coats of Bugman's Glow. So don't forget any tails on the small rats around some of the Clan Rats' feet. Just a few more steps and we're almost done. Now we can add Leadbelcher for all the metal details. Any weapons, edges to shields, chainmail, armour, and anything you can paint without making a mistake. Don't worry about buckles or rivets if you can't get to them. There is also a Skaven icon on the top of the standard banner, so we'll also need to paint that too. With all those base coats down, we're ready to shade them all like we did with the rest of our Skaven. Just nice light coats of shade to get into all those recesses, especially on those darker colours like the metal and red cloth. And now our shade is dry, we can finish off the bases with Astrogranite and paint the rims with Abaddon Black. Now you have your first batch of Clan Rats ready, and you can keep going until every last one is done. But if you're feeling confident and want to add something extra to your models, we can paint the Skaven icons on the banner and shields. This is an optional extra that you can do at any time or you can skip entirely. We'll take some Abaddon Black on just the tip of our brush and then make small lines in an upside down triangle shape. You can be messy with this, as the icons are marked out by large ratmen with basic tools. So it's going to have some rough ends and edges, and it can add to the Skaven style. You can see more examples of these icons on the box art. Or you can skip it entirely and just keep painting your last models of our Skaven army. Our last models in our army are the Rat Ogres. They share the same paints and steps as the Norbeast. As you can see, they look very similar. So let's run through them quickly for you. As normal, we'll undercoat with Abaddon Black. Then we'll paint the skin with Rakarth Flesh, and there's a lot of skin on these ogres, so take your time and get all those coats smooth. Then we'll paint the raw mutated skin and tails with Bugman's Glow. Then we can paint the eyes and cloth with Khorne Red, but it shouldn't take too long as there is very little of this detail. We'll use Steel Legion Drab for the teeth, claws and any bits of cloth you would rather have in this colour. Some weapon options may also have wood on them, so you can use this colour for this too. And then we'll paint the warpstone and the pipes with Waaagh Flesh. And then we can finish off the base coats with Leadbelcher for any metal details, such as chains, weapons or masks. Then shade with Agrax Earthshade as normal, making sure it's not too heavy on the skin. Then we'll use Astrogranite for the base and paint the rims with Abaddon Black. Now you can do this for all three Rat Ogres. And there they all are, a mass horde of Skaven ready to bite, gnaw and stab their way through the Stormcast Eternals. You've done a great job of getting all these models painted. If you have time or want to add even more detail to your entire starter set, you can add Agrax Earthshade on top of the Astrogranite to make the dark, stony grey texture even more dirty and lived in. But if you want to keep going, you don't have to, and we can keep on painting. So what is there left in the box? Oh yes, we have the scenery still to paint. These pieces are easy to build and use a similar amount of colours as the rest of our starter set. But we'll still go through what paints you'll need and show you the steps to get these broken and damaged walls painted. I'll show you on a piece of broken statue. Even though the statues and walls are in a lighter colour, we still need to give our scenery an undercoat of Abaddon Black. This just doesn't give us our foundation, but it also means if we miss some gaps, we can give them an instant shadow to them by adding some depth and character. Just a few coats and we're ready to base coat. For the stonework found on all the pieces, we'll use a couple of coats of Rakarth Flesh to create the lighter stone colour. You could also use this on any of the skeletons found around the walls. You may find this takes a little bit of time, but with all the practice you've had, it will be easier and quicker the more you paint. Now we can give it some Retributor Armour gold details. These can be anything from the ornate details found on the statues to hidden trinkets on shelves on the walls. Just make sure you have those coats nice and smooth. Then we can add Leadbelcher to any chains, trinkets, brackets, sconces, and the massive bell on one of the walls. On this statue, there aren't a lot of silver details, but you can always check the box art to see more of the details with this colour. For the wooden details, we'll use Steel Legion Drab. Nice, easy, and quick. Just make sure you avoid painting any of the details we've already painted. And the last base coat is Waaagh Flesh, and we'll use it for any warpstone items. On this statue, we'll be using it for the eyes, but on the walls, you can use it for the warpstone sconces and the massive branding on the wall. Then we can shade our details carefully. You might find it easier to shade one side of the scenery and leave it flat on the table to dry. This avoids any of the shade just pooling at the bottom of the walls. Talking about the walls, we want to make sure we don't apply this shade too heavily to the stone, so it just stains and runs into the recesses between all the bricks. You can always take some off whilst it's still wet if you think there is too much on there. And seeing the scenery has no bases, we can skip those last few stages and our scenery is all done.
From starting from unbuilt plastic to fully painted armies and scenery, you have done an amazing job of learning how to paint the ultimate starter set. You should be super proud of what you've accomplished.
Now you're ready to start playing with your armies in a battle of Warhammer Age of Sigmar. But if you've enjoyed painting so much, you can add even more to your models, or even start diving into other armies and miniatures.
If you want even more information about the techniques you've learned in this video, we have a Painting Essentials playlist on our YouTube channel, packed with lots of tips and tricks. Or you can visit one of our many Warhammer stores around the world, with our helpful staff ready and waiting.
We hope you enjoyed this Painting the Ultimate Starter Set video, and we'll see you soon.
Bye-bye!